and gentlemen, Point Fortin, please welcome the Honorable Stuart Young.
Point Fortin, good night. Members of the head table, Dr. the Honorable Keith Christopher Rowley, political leader, Prime Minister of Trinidad and Tobago, thank God. Mayor of Point Fortin, Mr. Abdon Mason. My cabinet colleague, Senator Franklin Khan, Minister of Energy and Energy Industries. Cabinet colleague, Major General, retired Edmund Dillon, Member of Parliament for Point Fortin, Minister of Housing and Development. One of my favorite, Lady Vice Chair, Camille Robinson Regis. My other cabinet colleagues, members of Parliament, senators, various chairmen of the various councils throughout Trinidad and Tobago, Point Fortin family, and I see many members from Port of Spain North, St. Anne's West here. Good night. Welcome to Point Fortin. I'd like to start by correcting the member for Point Fortin and telling him that the Queen's Park Oval is in Port of Spain North, St. Anne's West. Ladies and gentlemen, my task is a simple one here tonight, but an important one. It is to correct the record and to set the facts straight and to educate the population on what we have done in the energy sector and in particular the gas sector since September 2015. Gas sector is the most important part of our energy sector right now. Many people may not realize that. In fact, on the way down tonight, I heard on the news the leader of the opposition saying that she had concerns about our management of the gas sector. And that is so ironic, it is unbelievable. This is the same leader of the opposition, former Prime Minister of Trinidad and Tobago, who did not even know what the country's shareholdings in Atlantic LNG are. Can you all believe that? Atlantic LNG in Point Fortin is one of the most important LNG industries in the world, and we are proud to have it here in Point Fortin. And she did not even know what the shareholding is. And let me tell you why. When we came into office in 2015, we met a crisis. We met a complete mess in the gas industry. We had heard before 2015 all of the excuses in the world for the curtailment of gas. Curtailment of gas means that we had gas shortages in Trinidad and Tobago since 2011 and since 2012. What that means is we, NGC, buys gas from the upstreamers, BP, EOG, then British Gas, now Shell, Perenco. We buy the gas at NGC and then we sell it on to the industries in Point Lisas who make ammonia, methanol, urea, and what we call petchem. And we have contracts, and these contracts are to supply gas to the petchem industry. And if we supply them with less than we're supposed to, it means that they make claims against us in contract. All before we came into office, we were hearing of rumblings in the industry, kept very quiet, and we asked Kevin Ramnarine, what is going on with the gas? Okay, I think we're now going to welcome our political leader, the the Honorable Dr. Keith Rowley at a most opportune time before I get straight into it. So let's stand and welcome the Honorable Prime Minister.
Ladies and gentlemen, he is here, the Prime Minister of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago and political leader of the People's National Movement, Member of Parliament for the constituency of Diego Martin West, our captain, our flag bearer, our team leader of party and country, the man who has a vision and who is able to execute that vision for our country. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to put your hands together and welcome Dr. Keith Christopher Rowley.
So welcome to the Prime Minister, and as he enters at this most opportune moment, I can begin to say what under his stewardship we did to stabilize this country. So as I was saying, when we came in 2015, we met a crisis in the gas sector. We were unable to supply the amount of gas we needed to the Point Lisas Industrial Estate and to the petchem sector. When we asked the UNC what was going on, what was curtailment, what was the shortage of gas about, you know what they told us? What they told the country before 2015? Don't worry, it's maintenance. People of Trinidad and Tobago, that was a complete lie. Not unlike what they continue to do now by misinformation and complete untruths. When we came in 2015, immediately, when we got into NGC, and two of the first boards we appointed were Petrotrin and NGC, the Prime Minister recognizing how important energy is to Trinidad and Tobago. Immediately, NGC began to tell us of the disaster that had taken place between 2010 and 2015. And the disaster was as follows. We came in and met billions, $6 to $7 billion in claims had been run up against NGC for the gas shortages that the Kamala Prasad Bisesa government said there was no shortage of gas for. Worse than that, we also met, when you're negotiating the future of gas, you start negotiations well in advance. You don't wait for the day before the contract runs out. You start years in advance having the negotiations. We came in and realized they had not negotiated a single gas contract from the upstreamers, from BP, from Shell, then British Gas, and from EOG. Not a single one. So we didn't know where gas would be coming from. And then we had downstreamers who were purchasing the gas from NGC, making billions of dollars of claims against us. A complete crisis. We then had to find the gas master plan done by Fortin and Partners. And when we opened that gas master plan at the Energy Subcommittee of Cabinet, the Standing Energy Committee, which again was one of the first committees appointed by the Prime Minister and Cabinet, and I want to make this point. When we checked the minutes and the records, the former Prime Minister did not attend a single energy standing committee meeting during the tenure of 2010 and 2015. This country's revenues, this country's lifeblood stands on energy. How could you have a Prime Minister who didn't even attend the meetings? And we began to understand why we met a crisis. To make matters worse, so picture this, billions of dollars in claims against us, no future gas from the upstream, and then we found another potential disaster. As soon as we entered office, what we met were people knocking at the AG's door, saying you need to sign an opinion for a massive project in La Brea, the Caribbean Gas Chemical Limited, CGCL project, which is Japanese Mitsubishi, Massey Trinidad, and NGC are the shareholders. You need to sign this AG's opinion now. Well, I was then a minister in the Ministry of the Attorney General and looked at it. And what we found was unbelievable. On the day of elections, the 7th of September 2015, you had a then UNC Attorney General trying to force the public servants to sign off on this opinion. And the public servants put in red ink in writing, you should not sign off on this because the contract is a disaster for Trinidad and Tobago. So we press pause, tremendous pressure coming at us. The Prime Minister appointed a small group of us, I was part of that group, to look at this contract and to advise. When we began to dig, we found that the UNC regime had exposed us in Trinidad and Tobago to additional potential billions of dollars in claims. What they did is they told this project, we will give you first priority of gas. So all of the plants that we had contracts with that were already up and running for decades, if there was a shortage of gas, they wouldn't get the gas. The new plant would get the gas. Massive exposure. That would have been a constitutional nightmare and led to billions of dollars more in claims. We said we could not go ahead. We also found out that if we failed to supply gas, the government would have to pay the whole loan for the plant, hundreds of millions of US dollars, and we didn't even have the security of the plant. So what that meant is the UNC's negotiation, we would pay for the plant and we would not even have ownership of the plant. Does that make sense to you? But that is what they did. Another issue, and they like to boast about how they negotiated this. This is the state of how they negotiate for Trinidad and Tobago. They agreed to the lowest gas price possible. The lowest gas price. They agreed to sell the gas to this project lower than the price we are buying the gas at. So destined for us, the citizens of Trinidad and Tobago, to lose on the project. Again, does that make sense to you? Additional to that, what they also did with that project in their failed negotiations is they agreed with that project that they would give them basically a free for all. So what we had to do is we looked at it and they had signed all of the contracts except this AG's opinion. And the Prime Minister and the Energy Standing Committee said, we need to try and renegotiate this contract with the government of Japan and the shareholders. And that set about being our first difficult task. I jumped on a plane with Professor Brooks and Professor Jupiter, flew to Japan in a two-day turnaround trip with the authority of the cabinet and the prime minister, and sat across the table with the government of Japan and told them, whilst we believe in the sanctity of contract and we believe in contracts, we cannot, in all good faith, allow the people of Trinidad and Tobago to be subjected to this contract. And it was one of the most difficult situations I've ever faced professionally. Fortunately, because of our fortitude and because of the way we dealt with Mitsubishi and Massey and the government of Japan, the government of Japan agreed to renegotiate the contract, and that was our first averment and avoidance of a disaster on behalf of Trinidad and Tobago done by this government. What it also meant, if we didn't avoid that, was that actually that contract, and this was the fourth point, we were being sued by other persons in the downstream industry, in the petchems. They had taken us to court for billions. And that contract, entering into that contract, actually cost us one of the arbitrations. Because what the arbitrators said is, you're saying you don't have sufficient gas for the people who already had the contracts in Point Lisas, but you go and enter into a new gas contract, a new gas supply with CGCL. And because of that decision by the UNC government, we lost that contract to the tune of hundreds of millions of US dollars. But thank God that you and the rest of Trinidad voted in this government in September 2015. Because let me tell you how we dealt with that. When we now sat down with NGC, and by this time, Mr. Mark Loquan had joined us, we persuaded him to come back from Australia and to join the NGC team. And it was Mr. Mark Loquan, Chairman Brooks, and myself giving the guidance. What we did with those hundreds of millions of dollars of claims is we sat down and we negotiated new contracts. Would you believe that the NGC in 2010 to 2015 did not sign a single new contract with the downstreamers? What they were doing is rolling the contracts on a month by month. So they wouldn't even prepare to sit down and do the hard work. But they have the audacity now to ask, what is this government doing about energy? And they are worried about gas. I remind you all, they took $16 billion in cash. $16 billion in cash from NGC and spent it all over the place. Beatum wastewater plant, pavilions that were massively overpriced all over the place to a favored contractor, MAMU, SIS. That is how they spent the money. But they weren't even interested in ensuring that we had contracts to make sure we had money for the future. So what your government did is we sat down and we faced these sophisticated energy companies flying in from all over the world. And when they had their hundreds of millions of dollars of claims and they wanted gas for the future, we sat down and we worked through many nights and we negotiated contracts. So all of these energy experts now and all of these people who want to annihilate the NGC and get rid of the NGC as aggregator, again, thank God you have a PNM government and thank God you have this prime minister. Because we stood fast and we said NGC will continue to derive profit and to make money for the people of Trinidad and Tobago. And what we've done is we negotiated new contracts with the downstreamers and we took their claims, we fought their claims very hard and we worked it into the future gas prices. In the meantime, there was no gas for the future from upstream. And NGC had reached loggerheads with EOG and BP. And the gas was going to end in December 2018 because they did not do the work they were supposed to do. It's hard work. It's sophisticated companies with the best resources in the world. And in March 2017, NGC hit a brick wall. And we saw the distance, we saw the looming crisis about to take place. And you believe they have the audacity to criticize the Prime Minister of Trinidad and Tobago, from jumping on a plane and calling BP and EOG and the heads of those companies to meet him in Houston for him to use the weight of his office on behalf of us, the people of Trinidad and Tobago, to try and get them across the line. Well, I am proud. I am proud that we have a Prime Minister who's prepared to work, a Prime Minister who's prepared to take advice, a Prime Minister who is prepared to lead, and a Prime Minister who has surrounded himself with cabinet colleagues who have expertise and who want to do the best for Trinidad and Tobago at great personal sacrifice. And we jumped on that plane, and we were late because there was a storm in Houston, and we circled Houston. I was with the Prime Minister for over half an hour, rushed to meet BP. We could not even change from our travel clothes, went into the meeting with BP, and because of his interjection, we managed to secure our gas price and gas for the future of Trinidad and Tobago. And those on the other side who embarrassed this country during their tenure as prime minister. And when the BP heads, she did not even go to meet them. When she eventually rose from her slumber, asked them to come to her, met them in bedroom slippers and a bathrobe, and had no clue what BP were talking about, have the audacity to ask us what we went to Houston to do. Thank God we went to Houston. And the next day we met with EOG, and in 10 minutes, because of the respect that these companies now have for your government and your prime minister, in 10 minutes we got a gas price from EOG. And immediately the president of EOG, which is the largest shale gas producer in the United States, we are competing with for their money, where they're making hundreds of millions, billions off of shale in the United States. The prime minister persuaded them to continue investment in Trinidad and Tobago and agree a gas price. Immediately the president turned to them and said, you can now go and drill for new gas. This is the truth. So don't listen to the lies and the misinformation by those on the other side who really should hang their heads in shame for how the state they left the gas industry in Trinidad. It didn't end there. For many years, right here in Point Fortin, you all were one of the largest exporters of liquid natural gas in the world, LNG, out of Atlantic LNG. But when we came in, we found out that because of the old contracts that were entered into, and at a time when we were less sophisticated, we, the people, were not getting the maximum amount of money that we could have. So what did we do? You think we did like the others? Because I know what they did between 2010 and 2015. They sold out the country for a lunch here and a dinner there and a smile and a photograph and to feel good sitting in meetings with these sophisticated companies. This government didn't do that. We looked at it. The Prime Minister spoke to Minister Khan and myself and the cabinet and said, we're going to take them on. We are going to take on the largest oil and gas producers in the world who are here in Trinidad, and we're going to tell them, we want our fair share. And that is what your government did. And we had, for the first time in Trinidad and Tobago, an energy spotlight. Let me tell you all something. They are following Cambridge Analytica buzzwords, right? That's the playbook. So what they're throwing out now is secrecy. Everything is a secret to the PNM government, and you're not telling us all the truth. Again, I am standing here tonight as we've stood throughout our term, and we tell you as much fact as we can. With these gas contracts and these sophisticated contracts, we cannot give the gas price. So when you see them rushing to court for freedom of information, what they are trying to do, people of Trinidad and Tobago, what the UNC is trying to do is destroy your country. And let me tell you how. If they keep asking for gas price, every gas price we negotiate with a different player is a different price and a competitive price. So if A knows what B is getting and C knows what D is getting, it is going to make it impossible in Trinidad and Tobago. We have to protect that. They didn't negotiate a single contract apart from the one I told you about that almost collapsed the whole gas industry. Eh? But now they want to know everything. So let me tell you what we did. We were told by the experts that they estimated we were losing $6 billion US a year from the sale of LNG from Trinidad and Tobago. Now, I want to put that in context. What they're saying is the price that is being sold at in Trinidad, it is possible that it's being sold elsewhere in the world at a higher price, and we should get the higher price. That sounds good, but what you have to do is you have to look at the contracts. And you have to see whether we are getting the price in accordance with the contracts. And I am a lawyer. And what we did is we went and hired one of the best law firms in the world in energy, White & Case. We had Fortin and Partners. We had local lawyers advising us. And the Prime Minister said, we're going to take this to the country. We're going to take this to the world. And we had energy spotlight. You all remember that? I want you all to understand something tonight. The first people we invited to the energy spotlight before we had even told people about it was the labor movement. And I was there. The prime minister told the labor movement in the office of the prime minister, I am going to have an energy spotlight where we are going to talk to the country and the world about the state of energy in Trinidad and Tobago, and we want you to participate. They were the first stakeholders to be told that. And they were the only stakeholders who unfortunately did not participate in the energy spotlight. We went to the energy spotlight. Minister Khan and the Prime Minister told the country and the world looking on, this is the state of energy. We need to get more. The Prime Minister said, you have your shareholders. He has his shareholders who are the people of Trinidad and Tobago, and we have to get a better deal for the people of Trinidad and Tobago. You remember what happened? Energy, the energy industry and the energy chamber jump up. The so-called energy experts, the former minister energy, the ones who are commentators in the newspaper and on the radio, who have never run anything successfully in their life, say you're going to run all the foreign investment from Trinidad. This PNM government going to collapse the energy industry in Trinidad. Nobody is going to negotiate. Nobody is going to continue investing in Trinidad. Well, people of Trinidad and Tobago, I am happy to tell you that despite what everyone says out there, we always had a plan. We always had a strategy and a plan, and we're seeing them fall into place now. Completely contrary to that, what we did is we set up an empowered negotiation team, Minister Khan and myself leading it, with some of the best lawyers and experts in the world, and we sat opposite the BPs and the Shells. And for the first time, your country was properly represented in negotiations, Trinidad and Tobago. And we sat there and we negotiated hard. And when they felt they weren't getting what they wanted, they tried to get to the Prime Minister. They avoid Minister Khan and myself. They tried to get. And you know what the Prime Minister did? You know what this leader did, to his credit? On every single occasion, he said, go back and deal with Minister Khan and Minister Young, because they are the ones negotiating this deal. You had one who in bedroom slippers and bathrobe, who can't even negotiate her way to a boardroom, and they want to tell us how to do energy. Well, people of Trinidad and Tobago, I am happy to tell you here today that after over 18 months of difficult, complex negotiations, you can feel proud of your government for being able to sit across a table and take on the most sophisticated energy negotiators in the world, and we have gotten billions of dollars more for Trinidad and Tobago. In December last year, we finished the first round of negotiations with BP. We managed to renegotiate and got over $1 billion there. Recently, the Prime Minister led a delegation, including Minister Khan and myself, to The Hague in Holland, to London, and to Houston. And that came at the end of very difficult and complex negotiations with Shell. And again, to the Prime Minister's credit, he kept saying, I am not accepting any invitation to anyone's headquarters until you have closed a deal with the people of Trinidad and Tobago to the benefit of the people of Trinidad and Tobago. And what we managed to do is we managed to negotiate a new price for LNG for Trinidad and Tobago. And as Minister Khan was reminding me today and the Prime Minister, when we met in 2015, that Fortin and Partners energy report, it said you derive more money from the sale of ammonia and you derive the least money from LNG. That's what the world experts told us. I am happy to tell the people of Trinidad and Tobago, and I thank you, I thank the Prime Minister, and I thank all of those who had the faith in us and for the opportunity and the privilege to serve Trinidad and Tobago, and announce here tonight that the best deal for Trinidad and Tobago and our gas now is going to come from LNG as a result of the negotiations we did. For the first time, we are not tied to an irrelevant gas price. Let me tell you what we negotiated for the people of Trinidad and Tobago. A basket of prices. China is going to become and is becoming the largest LNG purchaser in the world. So we got part Asia. Europe is another massive purchaser of LNG. We got another third from Europe. And then the last price is Brent plus. So that formula gives us the best global price, a basket. So if it's low in Asia, we get a high price in Europe, a high price of Brent. That had never been done in Trinidad and Tobago, and that is what your government got for you going forward with the sale of LNG. And that has resulted in the future of gas and LNG in Trinidad and Tobago. We are going to get additional US billions of dollars for you, the people of Trinidad and Tobago. So all those energy experts who go on the radio, write in the newspapers, write reports, and think that your government doesn't know what it's doing, we now can say the proof is in the eating of the pudding, and Trinidad and Tobago will eat a better pudding in LNG going forward in the future because of this PNM government. So despite what they said about people picking up and running, it did not happen. And as you heard recently, Shell and BP and EOG are going to continue to invest tens of billions of US dollars in Trinidad and Tobago. And you know what they told us at the end of the negotiation? They said they've been negotiating these gas contracts and these deals with LNG since they started the LNG plants many years ago. And they said this is the most difficult and most sophisticated negotiation they have ever seen of a Trinidad and Tobago government. And I am proud to have been part of that. The downstream side, you all remember there was a specific plant in Point Lisas that sometime last year shut down. They said they couldn't reach a deal with NGC, so they shut down. And they only have 100 people working for them. But all of a sudden, the number of unemployment rose to 400, and the government was put under tremendous pressure. We don't know what we're doing. We're going to collapse the energy industry. You all remember that? But let me tell you all what happened. Again, that was your government knowing what it was doing. We stood fast, and we said, you cannot get the cheap prices you got before. You're going to have to reduce your margin. We will reduce our margin as well, and we will find what I call the sweet spot. And they figured, call the bluff, shut down the plant, the country would put pressure on the government and we'll have to cave in and give away the gas. Well, I am proud once again to tell you, this government did not do that. We sat down, we negotiated it hard, and I remember one night at 9 o'clock in the night, using language I can't repeat here to a live audience, and telling them, telling these sophisticated foreigners who come with an attitude they're doing us a favor. Well, they have nothing that has upset me more than people feeling they're brighter than Trinidadians and telling us that they will pick up their plant and leave. I say this at the risk of the Prime Minister being upset with me. You know what I told them? I said, I will be the first one. Give me a monkey wrench and I'll help you take your plant and put it on the boat and you could leave. And in 5 minutes flat, they realized the government was not playing, and we negotiated a gas contract with them for the next 5 years, and they're happy. You see, people, this PNM government cannot be bullied. And I want that to be the message to those naysayers outside there. But more importantly, you, the people of Trinidad and Tobago, understand something about this government. Everything we do in the energy industry and outside is being done for the people of Trinidad and Tobago and the future of Trinidad and Tobago. And we have done the same with one of the largest, Nutrien, one of the largest off-takers, purchasers of natural gas. We sat down, we had very difficult, complex negotiations, and we closed that deal. And you all would have seen this week, we signed a deal with Shell to get gas from Shell going forward in the future, and the deal that we signed is the best gas price we've signed throughout our whole tenure for the people of Trinidad and Tobago. And we also in that deal got something called a power tranche, because you see, electricity in Trinidad and Tobago is subsidized. And what we got Shell to agree for the first time is when we're buying gas for them, from them, they will give us a substantial amount cheaper for us to give to the people through electricity. And that is what your government did. So when you sit down and you hear people saying the government doesn't know what they're doing in energy, and the government, as I was coming down here, and the opposition put out a statement saying they're worried about the gas sector. There's nothing to worry about, not under this government. And that is why you must keep a PNM government in place. They're also screaming about gas in Venezuela. And I have never seen people who claim to be Trinidadians so happy to see things not go Trinidad's way. Because it's not for a PNM government. It's not for the Prime Minister. It's not for Minister Khan. It's not for the Cabinet. It's for the people of Trinidad. But I will also tell you all here today, without fear of contradiction, I am certain that we will get gas from Venezuela in the future for Trinidad and Tobago, thanks to this Prime Minister. And the stance that we take in foreign affairs is in no way driven by a need for gas from Venezuela. It is always done on principle. And once you have a government that will do things on principle, we will succeed. So ladies and gentlemen, in a nutshell, I could go on for long, but I don't have long left. In a nutshell, that is what your government, a PNM government, came in and met, a complete crisis and disaster where there was no gas for the future and we had billions of dollars in claims. We fought what we had to fight and we secured gas for the future and we continue to negotiate gas. And I just want to give you all one last warning on gas. Don't believe everything the experts tell you. Because you see, the experts sometimes have agendas and sometimes have paid for agendas. But as I told you all a short while ago, under this Prime Minister, who I am proud to have served under, we will not give in to bullying. We will stand firm for Trinidad and Tobago. I want to end, because I'm in point 14, on a different note, if you all will permit me 2 quick minutes. I feel sorry for all you down here, you know, because all you have a counselor down here from Cedrus, who knows long like Pinocchio to the back of that wall. Don't believe a word, he says. Don't believe a word that the chairman for the Siparia Regional Corporation tells you, Glenn Ramadar Singh, and people coming in by boats. Because again, your government knows what it's doing. Putting on my hat now as Minister of National Security, we knew what we were doing with the Venezuelan registration process and how to handle it. So when those people, I was about to say those imps, jumped out and said, hundreds coming in, and Ramadar Singh saying thousands coming in by the week, completely untrue. I stood up on the 14th of June when the registration stopped and they continued to say hundreds coming in, boats coming in every day. I went down to the radar center myself. Our radars are working and it was one boat that tried to come in from Venezuela and we stopped it after that time. So I will speak more about this in the parliament tomorrow. Do not believe a word they say. And we're counting on you, the people of Point 14, spreading the news, spreading the truth, and seeing what the government has done. And I thank you all for what you have done for us in Point 14. And I end on this note. I take this opportunity to thank the people of Trinidad and Tobago, to thank Port of Spain North, St. Anne's West, to thank the Honorable Prime Minister for giving me the opportunity to have served Trinidad and Tobago and giving me the opportunity to do the best that I can for Trinidad and Tobago, especially in the energy sector. And I thank my colleagues for standing steadfast up against the most sophisticated negotiators in the world and us coming away with better energy deals for the future and for the children of Trinidad and Tobago. And in conclusion, it would be remiss of me not to say, great is the PNM, great is the PNM, great is the PNM, and we shall prevail.